Welcome to the Marketing Trench. It's 2022. Good to see you guys. Happy New Year.
Is that what year it is?
I feel more like a marketing gutter right now with the last conversation we've been having with Ricardo here.
Ricardo is fired up today. It's a fair warning for anyone who has children in the car. I can't promise how this is going to go.
Yeah, so, this episode might not be appropriate for kids.
That's awesome.
We're going to be talking about not letting your 2022 plans get gym membership. And, you know, we talk on this show periodically about the fact that the three of us talk offline pretty regularly. And today's topic came out of a conversation Scott and I were having, because each of us are working on different things. We're building stuff. All three of us are building stuff. And, you know, one of the temptations that happens to people who are building, whether it's a business, whether it's you're just trying to build your book of business, whatever the case is, you tend to live in the future, right? At least we do. Scott, I, Ricardo, we've talked about this so many times. We live in the future. Mm-hmm. And it's hard sometimes to live in the future, to know what this, like how big this thing is going to be, but then to live in the daily reality of what it is right now. So you're thinking about that future self where you're making multiple six-figure incomes, you're closing, you know, 40, 50 files a month or more, whatever your metrics are. But today, those numbers look like 1, 2, 5, 7. And when Scott and I were talking about some plans that he's working on, I made the observation to him, don't let your big vision step on your daily wins. And so that really inspired today's conversation. It's something we want to riff on. I don't know that we necessarily have a intended direction for the conversation, but we've talked in the past here on the Marketing Trench, and I invite you to go to marketingtrench.fm and listen to previous episodes where we've talked about building your business plan. And it's actually fun because we had some differences of opinion about that one. It was one of our early episodes, and you know, we went back and forth about like what's the value of a business plan, especially for the kind of person who, like Scott's really into spontaneity, serendipity. Yeah. Ricardo, he's very data driven and says, all right, I have to make X calls to make Y numbers, right? And I'm like, what the hell is happening to me? I'm on fire. So the three of us we have very different takes on this, right? So go back and listen to the business plan side. But if you've built a business plan, today's conversation is going to be a little bit different. We don't want to talk about the value of business plans. We want to talk about how to live in the reality of having a plan and then and having that big vision, but in the tension also of having your daily realities. So that's the setup. And Scott, I feel like you and I have talked recently. You've got some thoughts here. How about I hand the mic over to you and you just kind of take it away here?
Sure. So what I thought we were talking about today, I don't want to assume everybody kind of understands the gym membership thing, but you know, every New Year's, January 1, actually it's usually like December 30th, yeah, everybody's like, I'm going to the gym, I'm going to commit, I'm going to go every day.
It's like December 13th, you're talking about how just absolutely trashed you're going to get eating all the junk food over the next 2 weeks. Yeah. But on January 1st, I'm going to hit the gym really hard.
I'm going to go and I'm going to get that gym membership. And I've done it myself over the years. And
we all have. You're lying if you haven't.
And like the first couple of weeks of January, you almost can't get in on any of the equipment. And then by the first week of February, the place is crickets. Yeah. And they're just like licking their chops because everybody's paying monthly and nobody's up anymore. I don't know if we ever actually covered the 12-week year in one of our episodes, but I really liked that approach because there's this whole annual goal setting thing that I think just has so many things wrong with it. And what I think we tend to do is we tend to have these grand plans. Like you said, Dustin, I want to be closing 45 units a month. I'm only closing one or two right now. But if I come up with this plan and I write it down, I'm for sure in 12 months from now, 360 days from now, I'm going to be closing 45 units. And I think a little bit of it comes from our of how we approach the problem and the perspective. And it's really, you know, this is the thing that bugs me about goal setting And I'm a huge fan of Jordan Peterson. And one of the things that Jordan Peterson always says that I really love is he's like, who the hell are we to know what the future looks like? We're just dumb animals running around. There's no way we're going to know exactly what our situation is going to be in 6 months or 9 months or 12 months. So it really is you really have to do something on a day-to-day basis, or you have to do something else. And where I found myself, where I was kind of excited about this conversation, is because I had kind of that moment in the last couple of weeks of December. I'm like, okay, I've got all of these great plans. I'm writing out all these notes. I'm writing out all these plans. And I'm like, oh shit, where do I start? Right? It's like, I've just got all of this stuff. And one of the things that I realized is I was putting all of these things in notebooks that I would have to go back to see. And I moved from California to Austin a year ago. And
leave all your notebooks at home?
No, I didn't. But what I did do is I left all of my visual devices behind. I didn't bring a whiteboard. So
you whiteboard everything.
So I had to go out and I got a whiteboard. And I got a little whiteboard calendar so that I kind of know what I'm publishing and on what days I'm publishing it. And then I got those big whiteboard size post-it notes that you can just put thoughts on and then you can just stick it on the wall. So what I'm really doing is I'm chunking up and I'm creating visual aids to keep me on track and just on for my day-to-day stuff. So I'm really just planning, you know, what do I got to do today? And instead of having it on a notebook or somewhere, I went back to whiteboards and I went back to these visual aids that have been an absolute lifesaver. My stress level went so far down because what I found myself doing is having all of these amazing ideas and knowing that I needed to start somewhere, but I just wasn't sure where to start. And so taking it out of the notepad and putting it on the wall and putting it right in front of me that I can go in and interact with has been just an absolute lifesaver. It's only 2 weeks in, but I mean, I feel like my productivity level is just at an all-time high. And it's not because I didn't know what to do. It's just that I did a better job of organizing the execution of it with visual aids. And it was so funny because it's like the most manual process you could possibly have. We're always talking about tech and all this stuff. It's like I gave up yellow pads. I use a Remarkable. So I don't even have notepads. I have to go find my great ideas. They're just buried in folders and pages and pages and pages of folders. They're still in one place, but they're not actionable because they're not in front of me.
That's awesome.
So for you then, part of the observation when we were having our conversation, Scott, that I was trying to make is it was a motivation point, right? It's like, how do you keep yourself motivated? How do you keep yourself going when you're not realizing, when you've not yet realized the numbers that you're dreaming about and frankly living for in some sense, right? Like that are keeping you motivated. And for you, it sounds like you've gotten some energy just out of process. Is that kind of a fair takeaway?
Because he enjoys that process, that process, he needs that process.
No, well, for me, what it is it's taking the time to know what you want to accomplish. It's okay to spend time on big, high-level goals, right? And I want to get to that 45. But at the end of the day, you have to back that all the way. You have to back into what is the daily activity or the weekly activity
that gets me to that goal.
Activity that gets you to that goal.
I think a lot of people just want to go from A to Z without recognizing, well, this is step B, this is step C, this is step D.
Or they come up with what Z looks like, but they don't bother to go back and define A through Y. You know, it's like they just like, I'm going to think about it. I'm going to write it. You know, what do they say? You write it and it comes true. Well, if you do it, it comes true. If you write it, you can go back and recall it. So, and that's really what it is it's just, it's those touch points. So you document it so you can go back to it and see if you're on track or whatever. But almost 100% of the time, if you set lofty enough goals, even if you go back to your goal, there's going to be pivots in there. Like there's going to be, okay, I thought this was what I wanted to do. Cause I can't tell you how often that happens to me. I'm like, okay, I've got this all figured out and I get into it. And then I talk to Dustin and Dustin's like, yeah, that's a dumb idea. And I'm like, that's a dumb idea. I got to go back to the drawing board. But it's usually not. It's 95% that's awesome. Right idea, but the execution wasn't right. I wasn't approaching it the right way. And I'm actually talking about, these are real conversations that Dustin and I have had like this last month on some stuff that I've really been trying to figure out. Yeah. And it's like every time I'm like, I'll spend, you know, the weekend, and I'm like, I spent all weekend thinking about this and I got it all figured out. And he's like, well, yeah, but that's dumb. And I'm like, oh, man, you know, what am I going to do to fix this now? So
we all need more friends like Dustin.
Yeah. But that's the other thing with putting it. That's the other thing with taking it out of your big plan and putting it into your daily thing. Like, you know, Carl White is a friend of mine. He's a coach in the mortgage industry. Almost his entire coaching group works off of what they call their DSP, their daily success plan. And it's literally a checklist of things that you're supposed to do every single day. And you just set what those daily goals are, again, based off of your long-term goal. But I think that's how you don't get gym membershiped is once you come up with your daily, once you come up with your grand scheme, you have to set that aside and then you have to start just focusing on the daily activities that'll get you towards that path so that, and then you just observe and iterate on the fly. But just writing it down and just having the game plan, if it's a gym membership, it wasn't a good plan.
Yeah.
Like, you give up on it in 2 weeks, it was never a good plan. Or you didn't bother to address execution at all.
Or maybe you were just too aspirational in your thinking, right? So me, like when I get gym membership, it's because I think I'm going to go to the gym and in like 2 weeks, I'm going to look in the mirror and I'm going to feel like I'm
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I mean, you work out 2 hours a day.
No, not even like that. I mean, nobody actually thinks they're going to go to the gym for 2 weeks and look like Arnold Schwarzenegger, though they kind of feel like that could happen, right? Like they're like, yeah, but maybe, you know, but it's more like you go to the gym for 2 weeks and you've made sacrifices. You got up early, going to the gym is hard. Maybe you've also chosen to change your diet at the same time, which,
I tried that for a week and I got sick.
Ricardo stopped drinking for a week. His liver went to crock.
Body broke down.
I went on straight keto, stopped drinking, and 1 hour of intense cardio a day. And my body said, nope.
Nope. And for me, what it is I look in the mirror after that 2 weeks and I don't notice a change. Now, part of that's because you just gym workouts and all this stuff, it's incremental. And the same applies, I found, in business, right? Like the growth is incremental, but you live with the incremental every single day and you don't notice it because it's incremental. Whereas somebody else might not see you for 2 weeks and be like, hey, you're looking a little different, looking a little slimmer, right? Mm-hmm. But like you don't have that person in your life or you just didn't bake that indicator into your plan. And so you're not getting the indicators, right? Like the indicator lights aren't changing. They're not blinking. And you're not getting the feedback. And as a result, you get discouraged, right? I that's what I feel like. I feel like the gym membership is fundamentally about not having the indicators in place to encourage you. But Scott's brain is going.
Well, yeah. You know, another good, it's kind of seeing the forest through the trees thing also, because like people that have kids or like when you get a new puppy and you're around it every single day, you don't see how big they get so fast. But like when I see pictures of Charlie on Facebook, I'm like, holy crap, is she getting ready to enroll in college?
I know.
It's like, I remember when she was a larva. She was just like this little thing. And now she's like a person walking around and talking. But like for Ricardo, it doesn't feel like she grows that much. But when I see it from the outside, so that's another dilemma that happens when you're executing things on a day-to-day basis, is you don't always have the ability to reflect on your progress.
The change or the progress doesn't seem to me right now. I'm working on shipping a mastermind, and it feels like the change and the progress that I'm making is so slow.
Yep.
But then when we do our weekly update to talk about wins and, you know, how we're tracking, it's like, holy crap, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And I don't see that because I'm just in the weeds or the details down here, but that progress is being made.
Well, that's hard because that progress is the motivation for continuing to go to that gym every day. so it almost comes down to, and that's probably what the whiteboarding represented for me. It was an opportunity to reflect on what I did every day. I want to get these things done today. I can look at the board at the end of the day and say, and feel like I accomplished something. Okay, great. I got through all of these things throughout the day. What do I need to get taken care of tomorrow? Just put it in front of me, being able to write it out there. It's like, it's that sort of visual, that visual aid where you can reflect back on what you're doing on a daily basis. Did you hear that?
Oh, yeah. I think actually your Yeti mic or whatever isn't on. I think we're coming through your computer.
No? Oh, you think so?
Yeah. It's also a lot of background noise.
Let me get my...
While you're doing that...
I'll try to fix that while you guys are talking about stuff that's way more important.
So, Ricardo, then, what do you do? What are you doing to keep yourself motivated through this mastermind project?
That's a good question. I think the stuff that I did last year. So when I sent out like the email to promote this, last year was a combination of me being at my old place. Hang on a second. last year was a combination of me being at my old place, like, my old job, etc. Even now we're a remote company, so we work in silos. Sometimes or oftentimes it feels like you work in a silo. Mm-hmm. It's really hard to bounce ideas around. Like I have you guys, and it's not as if I don't pick up the phone and call you and harass you and bounce ideas around. But still, it very much feels like you're oftentimes working in these silos. So what can you do to not get stuck in this pattern? So for me, I signed up for a thing called the accountability, the single malt mastermind. And what sold me was the copy on that website is just brilliant. And Matthew Kimberly is a coach, a phenomenal coach. But his whole copy about like drinking whiskey and this is the accountability group for grownups. Once a week, every week, we're going to ask you three things. What did you get done this week? What are your blockers? And what are you going to get done next week? Mm-hmm. And then he actually replies to you and gives you real-time feedback on what it is that you like that is challenging in your business. He helps root for you for the things that are going well. Like being a part of that group for me at this time last year was exactly part of what I needed. The second thing that I did was I hired that therapist / coach.
Yeah.
And it was because like I've been doing this long enough to know that I have the tools and the knowledge to do whatever I want to do. But sometimes you can get caught up in your own head. It feels like you're not making the progress that you want to make. But the reality is like, look at all this cool, awesome stuff you've accomplished. And it's hard to see that stuff. So I think we talk a lot about that in both the single malt mastermind, or we talked about it to some degree in the single malt mastermind. And then I have therapy to kind of champion me and say, to remind me, it don't always get stressed about the big picture. Look at these incremental things that you're getting done, and these are amazing. Like, don't forget to neglect those, or don't neglect those.
Right.
So for me, it was a lot of, I because I work remote, because I work by myself, and because just that I feel like that's how I operate, I had to build these support systems around me. And those are the things that kind of fuel me and motivate me.
Well, support system and accountability, right?
Support system and to a huge degree, accountability.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny that you bring accountability into it, because I've never been one that's been really great with the whole accountability thing. You know, it feels punitive to me, I think. And I feel like if I'm at the point where I need someone to hold me accountable to a goal, probably what's going on is I'm not committed to the goal in the first place. And I'm just like dragging my own body across the finish line, you know?
Yeah.
So I actually hired a business coach therapist too, largely because of hearing Ricardo talk about it on this podcast and also just in our offline conversations and how transformational it's been. And, you know, the reality is whatever stigmas people might have around either of those things, work, like personal life and work, for me at least, they're intermingled, they're intertangled. It's not like they're clean, separate threads. And there are times where my brain just goes on these loops that aren't, frankly, strictly logical, right? Where I find that some objective I've set in my business, in my business context, it feels weighed down by some narrative in my head, in my personal life, or my overall momentum is actually being drained before it can ever be applied to my business context. And that happens, you know, like you can be totally excited about and theoretically committed to some business objective, making $1 million GCI, you know, for example, whatever the case might be. But if you're taxed at every single turn before you even get to the start line, you know, like maybe you've got stuff going on at home, maybe you've got failed business ventures elsewhere that just keep coming back to you, whatever the case might be, you know, you're never going to be able to pour the energy you need to hit that $1 million GCI mark you're going for. And so having somebody who's outside of you, who sometimes just sits there and listens to you just talk out your loops, you know, is just the exercise of talking out your loops makes you aware of them. And that's, by the way, that's how your brain works, right? Like your brain literally carves ruts into itself, and it follows like a car driving a street. A brain, a thought will electronically follow that rut. It will follow that street. It will follow that pre-carved thing, and it will take the path of least resistance every single time. And so you'll find yourself kind of in these loops, in these thought loops over and over. And you may not even recognize that you've gotten into them, but that's where that outside person can help you get into them, or can help you recognize them and get out of them. Right. And so for me, as I think about gym membershiping and my 2022 plans, the weekly check-in with that outside person who can help me break free of my loops, who can help me to break free or recognize the things that are weighing me down and just kind of push me on them, has already proven to be very, very valuable. And if I were to suggest anything to somebody in 2022, it's don't be ashamed to get a good coach. Don't get somebody who's going to fluff you. I've had coaches that fluff, right? Don't get somebody who's going to fluff you. Don't get somebody who will just sort of sit there and affirm you and nod along.
Mine, you know, literally calls me out.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's funny. You suck. You're right. I am making an excuse.
God, I see you got a look on your face. What are you thinking?
No, I guess I'm just kind of thinking of that process and what we do with goal planning. And really goal planning is just sort of, it's not the thing that you, all it is really a compass point to focus on. And then you have to build the journey on a daily basis. Like, so it's really like you think of it one time, and then you have to completely back into it. It's kind of like everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die, right? So it's like, it's like, analogy. Yeah. Well, it just is. You got to put in the work. You have to do what you have to do in order to get to that, to that goal. So what you're talking about with the accountability and the therapy, and what I don't want to get lost in this part of the conversation is you're kind of using the word coach, but these aren't necessarily coaches. These are like therapists. These are like trained psychotherapists that you're having conversations with them about how you have conversations with yourself. And I think that is incredibly valuable, and that's way different than an accountability. That's way different than a coach that just says, did you make your 25 phone calls last week?
Right.
Why not? You know, what you guys are talking about is you're having conversations about why couldn't I pick up the phone? What is the internal dialogue that's going on that's preventing me from doing this?
But I'm doing both. So
right.
At my previous role, my job was by nature very analytical. Like I knew what numbers I needed to hit because I got paid on those numbers. So every year I knew that I averaged like, I don't know, 380 one-on-one appointments, and I thought maybe 10 classes a month. I knew the number that I needed to hit my goal. I knew how many that needed to translate into weekly. Like everything was dialed down weekly, daily, monthly. Now it's a little bit different because I'm doing stuff like on a national level, and but I still have a goal. I still have numbers. And it's like shipping part of my process here at Follow Boss is shipping these webinars. Well, so for these webinars, like my goal is 500 people registered per webinar minimum. Okay, great. How much prep time do I need for that webinar? I need 3 weeks prep time. Partner needs to have assets by this date so that we can start promo on these dates. And if I'm not hitting my registration goal, then it's how do we troubleshoot this to get our registration numbers up?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still part of like I'm part of a Slack group with a bunch of different business owners. And we bounce ideas around things like this. And then I'm part of even on Basecamp. So internally as a company, we use Basecamp to manage our projects. What I do like is that we make this, the marketing team makes these quarterly bets. These are the priorities and these are the things that we're betting we're going to ship this quarter. And then we prioritize them. Ricardo's owning, you know, launching our masterminds and events. He's also owning brand and visibility at, you know, at least two conferences per month. Allison is shipping our daily content machine. Like we're assigning tasks to different people and we're saying this, we're going to ship this quarter. Like that's the priority this quarter. And then we regularly check in on progress towards those goals.
What's the bet piece of it?
It's just, this is a project that I'm willing to bet we can launch in Q1. Like we're going to double down on this because we think this will impact the business. Here's why we think it'll impact the business. Here's who's going to own this project, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. And I've worked at a lot of companies. I've worked at a lot of really smart companies and I've never seen us get so organized about how we think through projects, as we are now. And I think that's pretty awesome. Because we're reverse engineering the process that it's going to take to get us to that goal.
That's where I was kind of trying to get to.
Reverse engineering the process that it's going to take to get us to that goal. We check in. We do weekly standups, and we just ask, "How are we tracking on your bets? Are there any blockers? If you need help or need us to check in, like let us know." So we're incrementally making progress.
So, you know, it's interesting that we've come back to this way of doing things, this kind of reverse engineering. And I'm wondering if, because it's not resonating with me. I hear what you're saying, and I think it makes a ton of sense for what you're doing. But it occurs to me that I feel like what I'm doing as the CEO of a company and what I'm doing trying to launch another company, reverse engineering is not part of my process. And maybe it's because I'm bad at it. I'm totally open to that as a possibility. But also I just feel like I'm in the void more. And I feel like I don't have like a clear sense of reverse engineering. Like, I don't know. I don't know how to reverse engineer the steps to opening a new branch of Lighthouse Escrow, for example. Right. Partly because there are things way outside of my control, like the time it takes a regulator to approve, or how quickly I can build strategic relationships and make strategic hires. It's not like I can say, if I send 50 emails, I'm going to get a day for the next 60 days, I'm going to get a branch. So I wonder if this is the difference between people who are doing sales and marketing and people who are maybe more in the entrepreneurial mindset. You guys have been in both, so that's why I'm floating this out here.
Well, I mean, to talk about reverse engineer with the example you just gave, I what things can you control? And it almost sounds like, let's just use the example of opening up a branch. What are the top three things that need to be in place in order to open up a branch? And it's not licensing. Licensing is after you've decided to open the branch, right? So like what do you need to open a branch? Do you need existing client base in that area? So putting a branch in that area is going to make your service level higher. Right. Do we have that? Check. Okay. I think there is a way to reverse engineer. And when we say reverse, at least when I say reverse engineer, it's really, I'm spending time on figuring out what the broad scope of where I want, what I want to do. But then all the rest of my time is on the minutiae and the daily tasks and the activities, and then occasionally reflecting back to make sure that you're still in that same general direction. Mm-hmm. So it really just becomes what Ricardo's company does, what I kind of like. And I was going to ask you, Ricardo, it sounds like, are those like quarterly chunks or like, this is what we can do this month? What's the time frame that they're kind of looking at to execute on some of those projects?
We always make those quarterly.
Okay.
So there's stuff that we ship and we do like on a monthly basis, but and those are just your standard part of the business. Like, we know we want to do X number of webinars per month.
That's the habitual stuff. The stuff that is consistent, you're going to just do every single day.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the leaps that you need additional resources or
That's the stuff that we map out quarterly. Okay. That's the stuff that we map out quarterly.
Well, that's kind of that 12-month year concept too. And I don't remember if we did a
we didn't do a dedicated episode, but we did talk briefly about it. Met him at a conference.
Oh, did you really? The author?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, cool guy. Okay. He was one of the speakers at a conference.
Okay. Yeah, so he brings a really interesting approach to this. If we haven't covered this, then it won't be too redundant. But basically what he says is the whole concept of setting annual goals is broken because you have no way of understanding where you're really just making shit up. I keep making this PG. You're really just making stuff up 12 months from now. And what he says is he says chunk everything into 12 weeks. And so pick a goal, pick a task and map out what it's going to take to execute this in 12 weeks. And then he says, take a week off and then work for 12 weeks straight and then take a week off. Just don't think of anything. Go on a vacation, do whatever you have to do, but work in these 12-month increment or these 12-week increments, which is quarterly, right? And I think that's a much smarter way to do this because at the end of the day, if it was you know, if it's important enough to you, it's important enough to do the tasks every single day in order to get you there. And I think 12 months is too far out for you to really grasp, especially with the last 2 years we've been through with COVID. You know, there's like, there's this really, gee, I don't know if I want to make plans 12 months out because who knows if the world's going to be here by then. You don't know what kind of emergency is going to come up. So I think that impacts us a little bit, but I think that's, it's really drawing it closer. I think it's drawing it closer is really what it is, what it looks like. And I think that's what helps me with my visual aids, because I can put everything in front of me that I'm working on right now. And I can map things out in a short period of time. And I have the visual reminders to see what I'm doing. I'm not thinking about what this is going to look like in 12 months. I have my next 2 weeks mapped out in front of me that I know that I want to get accomplished.
Yeah, that's interesting. I really love that 12-week year vision, because also it does, it keeps you more mentally present. Yep. Like you're saying, Scott. And for me, as somebody who's building in the abstract, I totally drown in the vision, and I get out of the present very quickly. And that demotivates me.
It's easy for you to get out of the present quickly.
Yeah, it's super easy for me. It's hard for me to stay in the present. It's hard for me to chip away bit by bit to have those incremental wins. And to feel like I'm actually accomplishing something. But the incremental wins actually will feel like bigger wins if they're in the context of a 12-week cycle, because you're going to put more realistic wins there, right? So, going back to the idea of the gym membership, and for me, looking in the mirror is like the ultimate proof, right? Like, I might feel better every single day. Let's just assume that I have more energy, or that, I'm just psychologically, I'm like, hey, I went to the gym. Good for me, But looking in the mirror, it's when I look in the mirror and I see a change that I really get that big endorphin hit, that I really get that like huge encouragement. The business equivalent of that might be something like landing an account, or stepping back and looking at, if I'm doing like a web project, stepping back and looking at a kind of a complete version one prototype, a mock-up, and you can do that in a 12-week cycle. Like just, say, hey, I want to have version one done in 12 weeks. That's realistic. And it's more accessible than saying by the end of 12 months, I'm going to have 1 million users. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just too far out.
Yeah, I mean, I think you get gym membershiped one of two ways, and it's by being unrealistic with your long vision, and it's not taking the short term actions seriously enough, or not taking the time to map out what the short term actions look like. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a daily thing. Like you said, it can be you can chunk it into this 12 weeks. What can I realistically accomplish? Well, what can I accomplish in 12 weeks if I don't sleep and my ears are bleeding? Right. And then you back it down from there. You're like, okay, I'm not going to do that. So what can I realistically get done? And how much time do I want to commit to it? It's just easier to visualize.
I think I use Things3 as an app on my phone. So on my phone and on my desktop, it's a little expensive. I think I paid $50 for the desktop version. $20 for the iPhone app, whatever. It's an amazing app.
What's it called?
Things3. Yeah. What I have on there is I have stuff broken up into projects. And I have a work project. I break everything off into projects. But then I have two specific folders. One is things I need to ship today. I won't leave the office or close my laptop until these tasks get done. And then I have priorities for the week, a folder that says priorities for the week. So required to ship at some point this week. And what I do is I log stuff in there. I'll go home, have lunch, do dinner, whatever. And I get emails and I know I'm going to forget to reply to this person. So I'll put it in my, I'll put a reminder, reply to Dustin or reply to this RFP or submit this request for proposal. And then I tag everything based on how long I think it's going to take me to complete. Is this something that'll take me less than 5 minutes, less than 15 minutes, less than 30 minutes, less than 45, less than an hour, or greater than an hour? And then I have stuff I tag like delegate to Stephanie, virtual assistant. And then I have stuff like delegate to operations because I need our ops team to sign a contract and submit wire instructions. Here are the wire instructions. I'm doing my best to live by this ADD, automate, delegate, or delete. Dustin and I, you and I joke about this all the time, but like I'm trying to get better about delegating or more efficient about delegating and figuring out who to delegate to, whether it's my team or Stephanie. Because I need to do the big picture stuff, and where I get lost, I get really lost, is in the smaller daily execution of things.
Yeah.
So being able to put stuff in an app like that, that says, this is the stuff I have to execute today. And I know I have the time and capacity to do it. Then I just chop away at it. Done, 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 done. Great. I can go get lunch, or I can reward myself with an old fashioned. This mastermind is kind of a big project because it's our first official mastermind, and it'll be a 2-day event with a welcome reception the night before. So like I've had to scout a venue. I've had to submit requests for proposals from dozens of hotels, requests for proposals for dozens of food and catering vendors. I got to throw a party. I got to get custom pop-up banners designed, custom workbooks designed. There's just a lot of moving bits and parts. Right now I'm stuck on shipping the landing page. But like mentally, I know how long that landing page is going to take me to do. And so I chunk it, work on the, you know, here a copy for the landing page. This needs to get shipped today. Work on the speaker section of the landing page. This needs to get shipped today. And then I just kind of start to break it up into a little project while delegating other stuff to people like Stephanie. Hey, Stephanie, what are the 4 closest hotels to the venue? Because I need to get a room block discount. Can you link me to the 4 closest hotels that are within walking distance to the venue? Great, thanks. And then can you also type up directions for how to get there and how long it'll take to get there if you're coming from like the San Diego airport or driving out from LA County?
Like you know what I love about that specific example you just gave, Ricardo, is that as you're saying it, there's a devil on my shoulder, or, you know, whatever, we'll call it the do-it-yourself devil. And it says, if I was doing that, I would just say, well, why delegate that out to Stephanie? I can just quickly do it. But I know what would happen. I would go through it. I would find myself in Google Maps. I would get bored. I would check Facebook.
Yes. Right?
100%. And then I would just go down some rabbit holes. I would check in with my Slack groups and whatever. And then I come back to it. I'd be like, all right, advance the ball incrementally a little bit more. And the point is, I would get lost in the easy task. And I would, and it would turn out that delegating in an objective, someone looking at you from a third person perspective, you like, I should have delegated it, right? But in my brain, I got the do-it-yourself devil saying, just do it yourself. You can do it. It's not a big deal. And how many of us lose productivity in a day because we listen to the do-it-yourself devil?
Everyone's hand should be going up.
Yeah.
I have a 2-page list of vendors that are food and catering, and then drinks, so cocktail vendors. By now, Stephanie knows my travel preferences, my preferences for type of food and restaurant, and preferences for cocktails. She literally emailed me and said, there's 4 bar vendors on this list, but I think I found the one that's more your speed. She sent me the link, and the second that page loaded, I was like, yep, you're right, they're hired.
There's an old-fashioned on the front page.
They do handcrafted cocktails. They're actual mixologists.
That's amazing.
like she just knows the vibe and the style. Like I could have wasted weeks submitting requests for proposals through every single vendor on that list, or I could delegate it to Stephanie so that I can work on the shipping the landing page.
It's so here's another shirt, right? In addition to the marketing trench up to my neck and ship shirt, we will now have the do it yourself devil versus outsource angel.
Oh, that's awesome.
Scott, you know, you like it more than you want to. That's the thing.
Well, what I really like in the pattern that I'm seeing here and where this conversation ended up going is ditch annual goal setting and really projectize the things that you want to do.
For instance,
your analogy, Dustin, you said there's so many unknowns about doing this office. Okay, what do you need to do in the next 90 days to determine whether you should open an office in another area? So if you just think about it in those terms, it's you don't have to, you know, the goal isn't to have an office open. The goal is in the first 90 days, what is it going to take to know what it's going to take to open an office potentially in 90 days? So I think that's where we just landed on this thing
And then Scott, actually, there's a few people that have asked me, and it does happen to me. Like, remember when I that party that I did or whatever, that stressed me out. When we did the live summit, that stressed me out.
That's because you had 2 weeks to put it together.
Yeah. Actually, 3.5 business days for the party and 3 weeks for the live summit.
I'm embellishing.
There's something like, part of it is like I enjoy or I embellish. I enjoy maybe that chaos. I enjoy having that hard deadline. Like that's probably something that if I'm being real with myself, I thrive on on that part of the process to an extent. And then, damn it, I lost what I was going to say about this. It's just like Scott said, just projectizing all of, oh, I remember people ask me, why aren't you more stressed out, or how are you not freaking out? How are you keeping it together? Ashley will ask me that all the time. Like, how can you still joke around and play around and be playful? And like, why aren't you freaking out? And it's this one has hit me really hard lately. And Scott always says that it's control what you can control.
Know what you can control, yeah.
And there's so much stuff that I have zero control over. You know what? Can't control it, so it's not going to affect me. I'm not going to let it affect me.
Yep.
Because control what you can control. We had a conference this week. I shipped our booth materials, supposed to arrive there next day delivery. There was a delay, so it didn't get there, and they don't take weekend deliveries. And so we had no booth materials. We had swag, but no booth materials. I can be upset about it. I can be a million things about it, and I can do zero about it. I can see the Apple AirTag in the case, and the case is literally sitting on the airport tarmac, and no one is around. There's zero that I can do about it. Zero. Is there a point in getting upset about it? No, because what does that accomplish? It doesn't change the fact that the case is sitting on the tarmac, and nobody will have access to it on Monday, and my conference started yesterday. Or when I'm like planning some of these events, it's, aren't you worried about this? Aren't you worried about that? It's like, well, I could worry about it, but I can't control whether people are going to come halfway down the strip or all the way down the strip to show up to this party.
Mm-hmm.
So you know what? I'm actually not worried about it. We chose a pretty awesome venue, and it's a hot spot, and it's Vegas. I'm pretty sure people will make the trek. But anyway, when I make decisions now or I take big risks, that actually sits in the back of my mind all the time. It's control what you can control, and don't worry about it. Don't worry about the stuff that you can't, because there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah, for sure. That's such an important distinction, because being able to identify those parts of your plan that you don't have any control over, those are those unknowns that we need to pivot around and that we need to be able to be flexible and move around. And those are always out there. They're going to be there. You're going to run into them. It's an inevitability. You need to plan for it. So as soon as you see it. So what this kind of reminds me of is, was it the real estate broker test? I think it was the real estate broker test. It's in California. When you're doing the training for it, they say, okay, the questions that people spend the most time on are the math questions, but there are rarely enough math questions on the test to really impact whether you're going to pass or fail the test. Like, you could literally skip 100% of the math questions and you will still probably pass the test. So what they suggested that you do is every time a math question comes, you just skip it and get on to the next one. And basically that's how they taught how to do the test. So it's 200 questions over 4 hours, right? It's 2 hours, you take a break, and then it's another 2 hours. And what we were taught is, read the question. If you don't know the answer right off the top of your head, mark it and move on to the next question. Because if you sit there and you start thinking about it, now what happens is psychologically your brain starts thinking, oh man, I'm wasting all this time on this one question. I wonder how many more questions are out there that I'm not going to know the answer to. So what they tell you to do is, if you don't know it right away, skip it and go to the next one. So, and then what'll end up happening is there might be 5 questions you didn't know the answer to right off the top of your head. When you finish the whole test, you're like, oh, that wasn't a big deal. Now you go back and you spend a little bit more time on the 5 that took you the time to do, or the math questions, go back and do the math. That was absolutely invaluable. And that really just falls into that whole thing of what ends up happening is we think we got it all figured out and we go there and we run into something, we get frustrated and we just stop because it's hard. Instead of saying, oh, okay, that was that unexpected thing. Let me just move past that and I'll go back and I'll look at that later, but I can't spend any time or any energy on it. I suggest you got to move.
I delegate that now.
So this thought, as you were talking, Scott, this thought popped into my brain. Don't be ashamed by the things that give you momentum. So it might give you, in the case of the test, I might feel shame for skipping a question, right? Because I think, no, you should know the answer to that question. Figure out the question. Like, that's my internal monologue, right? Like, don't be
gonna let it beat me.
Yeah, don't let it beat you.
Yeah.
Solve it. But in reality, we get momentum from getting through the test. So get through the test and then go back, right? And now you have momentum going into the question. You don't have the psychological worry of the uncertainty of how much do I have to do. You know, I've got 5 questions. Great. I know how much time I have. Now this is how much time I can spend on each one. Or however, and this has happened to me many times where I feel shame at the things that give me a win. Not like I'm doing something dirty or wrong, but like it's like sugar, you know, like I shouldn't have this much sugar. It's like, well, if you're burning through a project, enjoy the sugar, you know. For me, things that give me momentum are actually investing a little bit of time designing and prototyping something that just makes me happy, right? Other people can go wireframe things really fast and that's their thing. I can't wireframe. I need to get it out onto a screen and I need to see it to a higher resolution than most people do. And I kind of beat myself up over it normally, saying, hey man, like, you're putting too much time and energy. No, I'm giving myself momentum. I'm giving myself wins. And so, this goes right back to the whole idea of getting gym membership, right? Like, maybe it's enough that you don't see change in the mirror. Maybe it's just enough to let yourself don't feel shame that you get that energy, you get that endorphin hit, you get that win out of simply having gone. Just do it. Just go. And if those are your wins, just the fact that you're going and the psychological relief that comes from the fact that you know that, hey, you're putting in more work than you did and you're showing up to the gym, great. And ditto, if, someone just asked me what wireframing means. I'll get to that in just a second, but ditto if you're doing your business plan and, your win comes from just having made the phone calls. Maybe you didn't get any conversions that day, but you made the phone calls. So good for you. Wireframing, by the way, just means that you have almost like, think of like stick figures. If you were to draw, like if your goal is to draw a Disney animated film, the first thing you do is draw stick figures, right? That's basically what
it's mock-ups for. It's mock-ups for graphic design or mock-ups for websites.
I do that with our landing pages and like our websites right now. I wireframe it and then I give it to Hachi and I say, make an awesome logo for this.
Yeah.
Well, what's funny is wireframe has nothing to do with what we're talking about, but when in reality, wireframing is annual goal setting. It's very
storyboardish. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Very storyboardish. It's very broad. It's like, hey, here's what the story is going to be. But then as you develop the script, then you're like, oh, okay, maybe this relationship between these characters isn't going to work. We got to do this. And that's really what it is. But yeah, it's like, okay, I know I want to be in this place and I don't like the write down the exact number of units that you're going to close kind of thing. I just can't work that way. I'm more of a creative than a, you know, I'm going to make 100 calls a day because I know 10 of them are going to let me, you know, have an opportunity to open one loan or two loans or whatever. Mm-hmm. And that's the other thing is knowing your superpowers and working within what your superpowers are, delegate everything else. Because if you try to do stuff that you don't like to do, even if the little do-it-yourself devil turns into a do-it-yourself, you know, whatever, red-tailed hawk, you know, You're just like, no, sorry, I'm going to delegate. Go fly someplace else. You got to get out of your own way.
Outsource angel, baby.
Outsource angel.
Outsource angel, yes. Do-it-yourself red-tailed hawk. Yes.
Well, I think this is a great place to wrap up. For all of you who are listening, either live or, you know, doing the podcast, by the way, you can find all of our previous episodes at marketingtrench.fm. You can also find them on your favorite podcast player. Go back and give a listen to the business plan episodes if you haven't. I think you'll find it to be pretty helpful, but stick to it. Don't let your plan get membershiped, a gym membershiped. You know, take a look at the 12-week year. We'll have a link in the show notes so that you can download or buy the book. And we wish you great success. Honestly, we do, and we're here for you. If you have questions, you can go to marketingtrench.fm. You can use the forum to reach out to us. Also, marketingtrench@gmail.com. That'll go to all of us. You know, shoot your questions over. We'd love to hear from you guys. We'd love to give you some advice. We'd love to connect you with anyone that we know that can resource you, especially if you're going to listen to your outsource angel and you're like, hey, listen, you know, I'm not good at, say, social media. I'm not good at creating video content. Boy, do we have people you need to know. So that's the pitch. Guys, good seeing you. Happy start to 2022. Look forward to big things ahead.
We'll see you next week.
All right. Until next time, this has been the Marketing Trench.
Yeah.